About 252 million years ago, our planet was teetering on the brink of devastation. Ocean temperatures soared and oxygen levels plummeted. Volcanic debris and greenhouse gases clouded the atmosphere. On land and sea, ecosystems collapsed as one dominant species after another breathed their last breaths. As taxonomic families disappeared left and right, life on Earth was suffering at unprecedented levels. This was the end Permian boundary, and it was bleak. But let's turn back the clock millions of years to the core of the Permian period, when our planet's ecosystems were still flourishing with new and diverse life. During the early Permian, all of Earth's major land masses were coming together into a C-shaped supercontinent called Pangaea. Pangaea consisted of two main groups of continents, Laurasia to the north and Gondwana to the south. In total, Pangaea covered roughly 30% of the Earth's surface, and it was surrounded by an enormous ocean known as Panthalassa. The formation of Pangaea and Panthalassa brought significant climate and environmental challenges. With one major continent and one major ocean, some terrestrial environments became isolated from coastlines and starved of precipitation. Over many years, Pangaea's interior grew hot, dry, and arid. Only parts of the interior would have received annual rainfall. Many rain-dependent environments, like forests and swamps, shrank or dried up, replaced by vast deserts and arid plains. In these regions, plants and animals were forced to adapt to hotter temperatures and more hostile conditions. By the Middle Permian, a major transition was taking place among life on our planet. The loss of so many forests and swamps paved the way for new types of terrestrial plants. Until the Middle Permian, many dominant groups thrived in humid wetlands, like ferns and lycophytes. But Pangaea's changing climate opened the door for other groups of plants better suited to dry, arid environments. For example, conifers and xerophytic seed plants spread across Pangaea's interior, becoming increasingly diverse throughout the second half of the Permian period. The evolution of plant life was also influenced by a host of new herbivores. The most important animals at the time were terrestrial vertebrates known as amniotes. During the earlier Carboniferous period, amniotes were small and simple, superficially lizard-like animals that scuttled through trees and hid along the forest floor. But those little animals would eventually diverge into two major clades of life, synapsids and sauropsids, the ancestors of mammals and reptiles, respectively. Both groups diversified during the Permian period, but synapsids rose to dominance, specifically a subgroup called therapsids. Around 260 million years ago, Earth's woodlands and plains were populated by large herbivores, some with tusks or beak-like mouths, browsing on new varieties of seed plants. Carnivorous therapsids, some almost as large as bears, were apex predators in these ecosystems. Later in the period, therapsids evolved into advanced creatures called cynodonts, which shared many physical traits with modern mammals, like differentiated teeth and potentially hairy bodies. Compared to synapsids, sauropsids were not as successful during the Permian period. They struggled to compete with dominant therapsids, like dicynodonts and gorgonopsians. But as the world became drier and warmer, sauropsids found niches of their own. For example, a heavyweight sauropsid called Pariasaurus lived in dry ecosystems and used its odd-shaped teeth to chomp down on fibrous plants. Living alongside Pariasaurus was one of the oldest archosauromorphs, a long-necked, slender animal called Protorosaurus. This creature grew about 2 meters long and lived in what is now Great Britain and Germany. With long legs and a long neck, Protorosaurus looked almost like a stretched-out monitor lizard. In fact, the name, Protorosaurus, actually means first lizard, though it was not directly related to modern lizards. There were an abundance of animals diversifying during the Permian period. Insects and arthropods, for example, reached incredible levels of biodiversity thanks to evolutionary booms during the Carboniferous. A handful of insects and arthropods had already grown to terrifying sizes. Arthropleura, for example, was a millipede-like animal that stretched over 2.5 meters long. Arthropleura and other giants did not fare well in the dry regions of Pangaea, but plenty of other arthropods flourished, like beetles and roaches. While terrestrial ecosystems complexified, marine fauna rode their own wave of diversity and specialization. In lush, shallow waters, brachiopods and bivalves lived comfortably along the ocean floor, alongside sea urchins and many types of colorful starfish. Swimming over their heads were spiral-shaped cephalopods, feeding on plankton, small crustaceans, and a variety of other marine organisms. Fish were also commonplace, including cartilaginous fish like ancient sharks. Had the Permian ended in a peaceful manner, there is no telling how life on our planet may have evolved. But as this period came to a close, the trajectory of life would be forever changed by the greatest extinction event in Earth's history. This event is known as the Permian-Triassic, or PT extinction, and it marks the boundary between the Paleozoic and Mesozoic eras. The PT extinction officially began 252 million years ago, but extinction pulses likely radiated throughout the final years of the Permian period. Some scientists believe the PT extinction intensified gradually over millions of years, while others believe it escalated over a shorter period, perhaps a couple of 100,000 years or less. Regardless, the PT extinction was the most severe extinction event ever known. It annihilated the vast majority of life on our planet, including 80% of marine species and about 70% of terrestrial vertebrates. Around 57% of all taxonomic families vanished from the fossil record during this catastrophic episode in our planet's history. What exactly caused the PT extinction event remains a subject of scientific debate, but the primary driver was likely a series of massive volcanic eruptions in modern-day Siberia. These eruptions ejected millions of cubic kilometers of lava and volcanic debris. As clouds of ash poured into the sky, Earth's atmosphere was filled with unsustainable amounts of greenhouse gases, such as carbon dioxide. Even more greenhouse gases were released by coal seams and forests, which were set ablaze by magma and volcanic debris. Rampaging wildfires released even more ash and smoke into the atmosphere, darkening the sky and blocking sunlight from reaching the surface. Without light shining down on the surface, producers, like plants and phytoplankton, experienced dramatic die-offs, which not only crippled ecosystems, but also disrupted Earth's natural carbon cycle. Producers typically reduce the amount of carbon in the atmosphere via photosynthesis, but without light, producers could not perform this critical biological process. As a result, massive amounts of carbon dioxide lingered in the atmosphere, thus trapping heat and raising global temperatures. This temperature crisis would have severe consequences for Earth's climate and biosphere. Conditions were already warm during the late Permian, but the PT extinction event caused temperatures to climb to deadly extremes. Ocean temperatures reached as high as 40 degrees Celsius, or 104 degrees Fahrenheit, in tropical waters, much too warm for most marine animals to bear. This warming trend also made it harder for the oceans to retain oxygen, triggering widespread anoxic events, in which large ocean areas were starved of the oxygen necessary to sustain life. This was especially devastating for populations of marine invertebrates living along the ocean floor. Trilobites, blastoids, and rugose corals were just a few of the invertebrate groups that vanished around 252 million years ago. Larger marine animals also suffered dramatically. Several vertebrate groups, like eugeniodontids and adestids, disappeared from the fossil record. At all trophic levels, this extinction event was a death sentence for marine life. The greatest losses during the PT extinction occurred underwater, but terrestrial ecosystems experienced their own waves of devastation. Many groups of large animals dwindled and died off, including apex predators like gorgonopsians and heavyweight herbivores like pariasaurs. Even some groups of insects, which were more resistant to the extinction, declined dramatically. As dominant populations weakened, the dynamics of terrestrial ecosystems became unstable, opening the door for new species to rise from the shadows. As the PT extinction came to an end, the sun rose on a new chapter in the history of life. It was the dawn of the Triassic period, the first period of the Mesozoic era, and ecosystems were beginning the long road to recovery. It would take about 5 to 10 million years for animals at all trophic levels to bounce back, but as they did, new ecosystems took shape, with different creatures standing on top. Therapsids were dominant throughout the Permian period. However, the dry conditions of the early Triassic were better suited to reptiles. An explosion of reptile diversity between 250 and 245 million years ago brought forth countless new species, including the first true archosaurs. These reptiles filled open ecological niches, often thriving in the hot climate around Pangaea's interior. Archosaurs would soon rule the Triassic world, and eventually diverge into some of the largest reptiles ever known. A similar transformation took place underwater, as ocean ecosystems gradually recovered from the PT extinction. Marine invertebrates, like corals, suffered the greatest losses, so they were slower to recover than free-swimming animals, such as cephalopods and bony fish. Among the most successful species were reptiles that gradually adapted to marine life. These reptilian ancestors evolved into key carnivores, like ichthyosaurs, which became dominant predators across shallow and deep-water ecosystems. By the late Triassic, the oceans were full of intimidating marine reptiles that would rule the oceans for the rest of the Mesozoic era. 252 million years ago, life on Earth faced one of its greatest ever challenges. Most creatures simply disappeared, endangering the lineages of modern flora and fauna. For all its destruction, this worldwide extinction was a critical juncture in the history of life, a time of volatile transformation. The ecological scales tipped in favor of new species, and from that moment forward, life on Earth would never be the same.